Now it's time to finally finish off Final Fantasy IV by taking a look at Final Fantasy IV Interlude, added to the game with this PSP remake. This one won't be as thorough as the main game. I'll be collecting all the treasures and filling the bestiary, but I will not be maxing levels or stats as I've already done that in the main game, and this side story is 99% reused assets, which is also why I'm classing it as part of Final Fantasy IV and not its own game. It's set a year after the game and exists to bridge the gap between it and its sequel a little. On starting a new game, we can see one of the underworld's crystals glow, then what looks like Rydia appear in front of it before collapsing. Meanwhile, in his sleep, Cecil hears a voice talk about finding a new form. Cecil asks what this voice, represented by a blue light, is, but before it can tell Cecil, he's woken up by Rosa. She says that Cecil looked troubled in his sleep, but Cecil dismisses it as nothing. Rosa says that it's the day of the celebration of Damcyan's reconstruction. The Red Wings are already waiting to take them there. Now I have control, I can check the menu and find that after all those hours maxing everyone's levels and HP and MP, these lazy bastards have let themselves go so much they've dropped over 60 levels and all those apples and soma drops have worn off. Ungrateful pricks. We're pretty much railroaded outside, but I can make a detour to loot the same three chests once again for a dry ether, 4800 gil and a tent. We can also talk to a few people. One white mage mentions that they're now teaching white magic in Troyer, which is supposed to foreshadow a new character in the sequel. We also get to learn that Cain still hasn't returned to Baron. Good, it can stay fucked off and as far away from this plot as possible. Also, since the Lunarian's moon left on its journey, there's been some slight environmental changes to the world map. All that's left to do is leave the castle and automatically end up on a red-winged ship. We're gonna go ahead while Cid follows behind on the Enterprise. FF4 got their own Biggs and Wedge in the sequel, so they were added into this story too, with Wedge being the second in command and Biggs being the incredibly strict captain. Talking to Biggs gives me the choice of setting off. No reason not to. It's not just my levels, even the airships have gotten crappier in the last year. They used to move about 3 or 4 times faster than this. As the title appears on screen and fades out, we're suddenly with Rydia in the Feymarch, on the middle level. Treasures are in the same place they were in the original game. Alarm clock, Phoenix down, 5000 gil, 6000 gil, ether, maiden's kiss, Yoichi arrows, elixir, dry ether, killer bow. On the upper level, Queen Asura is standing over the entrance. Rydia states her intent to visit the celebration at Damcyan, while Asura thinks it may be best for Rydia to stay in the human world. But Rydia considers the Feymarch just as much her home as the surface, which eases Asura's doubts. Once she leaves, our slow-as-fuck airship still hasn't even passed Kaipo yet. This used to be a 5-second flight. Cid catches up with the Enterprise, and Cecil reacts as if that's in any way an accomplishment. Soon after, everyone lands outside Damcyan Castle. So I get off the ship, and before I enter the castle, it's time to add some entries back into the bestiary. Sandworm, Hundlegs, Goblin, Eyewing Moth, Lava, Desert Sahagin, Sword Rat, Tiny Mage. Also, we can't enter the underground waterway as there's a guard blocking the entrance. There's also now a bridge east of the castle to the Antlion's Den, which is also blocked by a guard. With all that done, I enter Damcyan Castle. Edward and I are buddies, so I'm certain he won't mind me raiding the castle treasury for old time's sake. High Potion, Unicorn Horn, High Potion, Antidote, Potion, Holy Arrows, Aether, Phoenix Down, Gold Needle, Holy Arrows, Phoenix Down, Phoenix Down. The place is in a much better state than when we last saw it, with people living here and flowers placed everywhere. Inside, where there used to be just the stairs to the throne room, there's some shops off to the right. I grab a tent from the pot in between them. Then I can go further right and enter the storehouse, where I can go south into the wall and grab an antidote from a chest and an ether hidden above it. Then while visible, I can get a potion before moving up the stairs into the right side of the throne room. Then going up more stairs, I can snoop around Edward's bedroom. Look, Baron funded this reconstruction, so as king, I'm free to do what I like. But there isn't actually anything to do in here. Back to the shops, on the left side of the room is an inn. Up the stairs is a children's playroom, but up the stairs I can't get any higher than that. I return to the second floor and keep going up the stairs to the throne room. We're greeted by a character from the after years, Edward's secretary Harley. For some reason they refuse to name her though. Cid, Young, the twins, the Mycidian Elder, and one of the Epops are already there. Edward starts by thanking everyone for helping out Damcyan's reconstruction. Palom gets impatient and tells him to hurry his speech up, which gets him a whack from Porom. But Edward just finds him funny. It's a little thing, but nice to see, since these two never got to interact in the original game. Edward finishes up his speech and everyone disperses into the most depressing looking party I've ever seen, so I just have to check on everyone. Rose is on her own, distracted and in her own head. The rest have nothing interesting to say, but it does make me wonder what the hell 60-year-old Porom and 55-year-old Cid could possibly hold a conversation about. Young, like Rosa, is alone and seems distracted over something. When asked, he changes the subject. Harley says that Rosa looks pale and is worried she's unwell. Finally, I talk to Edward. Cecil asks if Rydia and Edge are showing up. He doesn't ask about Kane, cause fuck him, I wouldn't invite him. Edward just assumes they're running late. Cecil wonders what Edward did with the crystal to keep it safe, as the castle is now completely open to the public. Edward is so proud to have thought of hiding the crystal chamber behind a switch on the wall. It's not like Fabul Castle and the Dwarven Castle already thought of that before and it didn't work out. Palom is fascinated and runs right in, with Porom going in after him. The two admire the crystal for a bit, and after talking to both, Porom says they should head back. Cecil goes to leave, but hears a sound from the crystal. He goes back to look at it, but assumes he was just imagining things and returns to the throne room. Suddenly, a soldier barges in to report an incident on Mount Hobbs. Their lookout has seen a group of monks from Fabul beaten unconscious on the mountain summit. Yang has to go deal with this while Cecil and Rosa volunteer to join him. Well, I'm not allowed to use the airships, so I just have to walk to Mount Hobbs, now possible thanks to that new bridge I mentioned earlier. It doesn't take long to get there. I'm not going to map these screens out for chests, I already did it once before and all the chests are in the same place as they were originally. On this first screen, I had Fledgling Rook, Gargoyle and Belphegor to the Bestiary before I move on to the West Vista. Soul, Balloon and Grey Bomb to Bestiary, Tent, Potion, Gold Needle and 960 gil from the chests. Blood Bones added to Bestiary, return to West Slope and move on to next screen. But there's some new screens. Instead of going straight to the summit, we now have the West Crossing to go through. Now with this being a new screen, I'd like to map it out like I've done in previous episodes. However, it seems nobody has uploaded the Interlude exclusive maps, so I can't do that. So all I can say is that this screen is a long winding path from the centre to a door in the top right corner of the screen. Magma Tortoise added to Bestiary. Near the end, there's a fort going south around the outside to a chest containing a cottage. Then it's the door to the summit. Chest contains holy arrows. I return to the spot I faced the Mon Bomb to find two unconscious monks. Rosa heals them and they try to tell Yang that they have news regarding his wife before they are interrupted by another bomb. In this case it's the first new enemy of Interlude, the Dad Bomb with 12,200 HP. We also got Monk A and Monk B in the party, they're just inferior Yangs. This is just straight up the Mon Bomb fight once again, but he's stronger with its blue flame attack that hits the entire party. I just have everyone but Rosa fight while Rosa heals. Eventually it will self-destruct and split into 3 grey bombs and 3 balloons I'll have to kill. Going by release order, this is the third time using this fight in this location, as the After Years also repeats the Mon Bomb fight on Mount Hobbs' summit. Yang tries to talk Cecil and Rosa into going back to Damcyan, but they're worried about Sheila too. Taking the door leads us to another new room, the West Vista. Here there's a lot of bridges to cross with a save point. Alarm clock from a chest, Scolger added to Bestiary, Remedy and Bronze Hourglass from chests before I go through the door in the bottom right corner to reach the new East Trail screen. Maiden's Kiss and Headband from chests, and slightly south is the door that returns me to the East Slope. But before I leave, I still have one more enemy to kill for the Bestiary. For some reason, it takes another 20 minutes just for the normal bomb to appear. But with that added, that's all enemies here and I can now leave and get walking to Fabul. Domovoy and Gatling Hog arrive to the Bestiary on the way. No Chocobo Forest either, I thought I'd check in case the items were still hidden in there. I enter Fabul and the monks resume their job of standing in front of this door. The Duke Consort, the former king, shows up and tells Yang that his child will be born at any moment. Cecil tells Yang to go to Sheila, but Yang decides he can't do anything to help now and will distract himself by training his students until the child is born. So instead, Cecil and Rosa will keep her company. After looting the treasure in the throne room, of course, spider silk, elixir, ether, Hermes sandals, I'm also allowed to just waltz into the crystal chamber unchecked and loiter around the wind crystal. In the Eastern Tower, I grab a Bacchus's wine and a tent. Then in the Western Tower, Zeus's Wrath, Potion, Bomb Fragment and Antarctic Wind. Then I go up to the top floor just in time for the baby to be born. Yang and the Duke Consort show up right after. Yang gets a moment to take in his newborn daughter and Cecil asks why Yang never told anyone they were expecting. Yang just didn't want to hijack the celebration with his personal life. Yang asks Cecil to be the baby's godfather and to name her. Cecil comes with Ursula. Like Harley, we are meeting this character out of order. She's an important character 16 years later in the After Years, which was released 3 years before Interlude. Suddenly, everyone can hear an airship and Cecil looks out the window to see the Falcon land outside. This confuses Cecil since he left the Falcon with the dwarves. Cid, the twins and Luca all arrive. It turns out that monsters are swarming out of the sealed cave and the dwarves can't fight them off alone. Cecil agrees to help, as does Yang, but Cecil makes him stay behind to stay with his family and actually pushes Yang back onto his throne. Rosa also agrees to help, but at this point Cecil finally notices how weak she looks. She tries to get everyone to forget it, but she's convinced to stay behind in Fabul where she'll be looked after. So Rosa leaves, but we gain Cid, Palom and Porom. All there is to do is leave Fabul and get on the Falcon. To get going I have to speak with Cid's apprentice. Once again movement is automated. While that's going on, we cut to Eblan Castle, where Edge is instructing Gecko and Zangetsu from the After Years to watch over the castle while he's gone. Just those two, because Izayoi would still be a child, and Tsukinoa most likely hasn't even been born yet. So Edge knows that the celebration at Damcyan ended hours ago, but he's deciding to just show up anyway. That's not how being fashionably late works, that's just being way too fucking late. Meanwhile, back at the Falcon, it's still taking forever. We just see it pass Mithril, and that's nowhere near Agar. I have a chance to talk to everyone, but the only interesting part is Cid mentioning Luca's potential as a mechanic, setting up her role as Cid's apprentice in the After Years. After talking to everyone, we finally reach Agar and enter the underworld. We land right outside the sealed cave, and before I go in, there's one dwarf that sells weapons. I buy Cecil the Index Finger, a weapon introduced in advance I never used, but it's strong enough and does good damage against Flans. Before I enter the sealed cave, there's some underworld monsters to add to the bestiary outside. Caterpillar, Hellflapper, Bloodflower, then it takes nearly 10 minutes for Tunneler to show up. After that, I can finally enter the cave. The sealed cave's layout is exactly the same as it was last time, so all I have to point out is bestiary entries and treasure. So for B1, Naga and Trapdoor to bestiary. All trapdoors are back in the same place as they were last time as well. Phoenix Down, Aether and Maiden's Kiss in chests. Storm Anima and Black Flan to bestiary, High Potion and Aether in chests. Chimera Brain to bestiary, Power Armor and Phoenix Down from chests. Vampirus and Bloodbat to bestiary. For floor 2, Alarm Clock, Phoenix Down, Dry Aether and Elixir from chests. Vampire Bat and Yellow Dragon to bestiary. Forge Corrupted on these 3 chests containing Fuma Shuriken, Elixir and Light Curtain. Gaia Hammer which goes on Cid, Dry Aether, Shuriken and Aether from chests. For B3, High Potion and Phoenix Down from chests, Chimera to bestiary. Elixir, Antidote, Phoenix Down, Dry Aether and X Potion from chests. Also, throughout the entire dungeon there have been dwarves hanging around handing out encouragement. Then the rest of the cave is the same until I reach B5, and on a familiar bridge the ground starts shaking. Yep, we have to deal with the demon wall again. I have a different pie, but it's still basically the same. Slow it, then heal with Porum, then follow with strong spells from Palum while Cid and Cecil attack. After being slowed, it really isn't a threat. I enter the crystal chamber to find Rydia passed out in front of the crystal. No one has any idea what she's doing here, and once she wakes up, she ignores Cecil's questions about not being at Damcyan and talks about how she must go. Cid recommends taking her to the Falcon and she joins the party. She's also missing every single Eidolon. Nothing else to do but leave. At the entrance, Rydia talks about being called and confuses everyone some more. I return to the Falcon and talk to Luca. She's just as confused as to why Rydia's there, and Rydia wanders off and talks about the calling again. Suddenly, everyone can see the Tower of Babel turning red for a moment. With Rydia only saying its name, the only option is to fly the Falcon there. While that's going on, we cut back to Edge in the cave of Eblan. But first I leave to see that the landscape changes have made the cave accessible by land from the castle, no hovercraft needed anymore. Flamehound, Black Lizard, Rook, Mars and Armadillo put back in the bestiary. Now back in the cave, the floor B1, Yoichi Bo, Remedy and Vampire Fang from chests. On floor B2, the inn and shops are abandoned since everyone's back in the castle, but there is a healing pot by the exit. Also a potion and twin stars in other pots. In the path to Tower of Babel, Aether from a chest, Basilisk to bestiary, Tent and High Potion to chests, Lilith to bestiary, Bomb Core, Phoenix Down, High Potion, Cottage, High Potion, Elixir, Twin Stars, Spider Silk, Silver Hourglass, Phoenix Down, Kotetsu, Gold Needle and Dry Aether from chests. After that I have just one more enemy to kill, but after 10 minutes it just won't show up, so I move on to the Tower of Babel. I don't know why every area has to have one normally common enemy that this time takes forever to show, but I can get it later. In the Tower of Babel, there are exclusive enemies on this one tiny bit of bridge. Black Knight, Marionetteer, Ogre, then my battery runs out. Can't have the charger plugged in while recording as it destroys the image with this red static shit. 8 minutes of fighting later, I finally get a Giga Skater to show up, then 2 minutes later, Ketshi. With that, I can finally cross through the hidden passage Edge used last time, which has Edge confirm the reason he came here. He suspected that someone has been inside the tower. He walks on his own past the chests as it fades him back to Cecil's party. As the Falcon arrives at the Tower of Babel, Dwarven tanks are already set up outside. Cecil asks Cid to stay behind to free up space for Edge when we meet up with him, or for air support, whichever you believe. Outside the tower, I add Goblin Captain to the bestiary and buy Cecil a diamond helm, diamond armour and diamond shield before I enter. For floor B13, ice arrows and aether from chests. As I reach the door to the next room, a monster comes out and attacks. Frost Beast gets added to the bestiary. It's slightly stronger than a normal one, so it gets added as Frost Beast 2. Killing it has Shiva return to Rydia. For floor B12, Green Beret from a chest, Evil Doll and Ice Lizard to Bestiary, Ribbon from a chest, Mystery Egg, Ghost Knight and Normal Frost Beast to Bestiary. The door to the next room opens up to another monster, a powered up Green Dragon. Killing this one gets rid of Yarama again. Kiko Ichimonji from one more chest. Then floor B11. X Potion, Phoenix Down, Side Visit to B10 for Killer Bow and Antarctic Wind from chests. White Moose to Bestiary, back to B11. High Potion from chest. Another monster comes from the next door, a powered up Flamehound. Killing this one returns Ifrit to Iridia. Then to the main part of B10. Giant Skills from a chest and in the room next to it, Humming Wave that takes me to the developer's office. This time it's filled with people who worked on Interlude and the PSP version in general. Once again, I'll skim over this. The first guy I talk to, Michisuke, is getting married after finishing this game and thinks we're gonna interfere, so he fights us as Zemus's Breath. Considering this was released 11 years ago, it does make you wonder where the people who talk about their plans after finishing the project are now and how those plans went. There's Long, pulling an all-nighter who gives me a 10. There's Mao, who fights me as a skeleton and responds to attacks by asking for feedback on his dummy map. New guy Nakamura gives me some eye drops. Hunter Arthiodex gives me an elixir. Otsuma talks about his method of staying awake and gives me an alarm clock. Deeper into the office, Yoichi gives me a Soma drop. There's a nameless game designer who attacks me as a zombie, screaming about the grind development is. They have thousands of HP and when defeated, drop Cecil's favourite dwarf pawn. Deeper in is the clubhouse, where there's a long line of women just desperate to get a handshake and chat with Miyupi, who gets to be a unique palette swap of Seodor from the after years. I give him my dwarf pawn and in return I get a golden apple. And giving him an elixir, dry ether or remedy will have him calling dancers for me. That's about it, and I leave. Doesn't quite have the novelty of the original, but if the original dev team and the after years team get their own office, then these guys deserve to get one too. Back on floor 10, Aegis Shield from its last chest. Another monster comes from the door to the next room. This time it's a powered up tunneler that spams Earthquake. As you may expect, killing this one has Rydia regained Titan. Onto floor 9, the one where Yang survived being blown up. Arctic Wind from a chest, Flame Knight to Bestiary. I head towards the cannon room, where Rydia goes in alone. The door locks on the party, but then opens to reveal another monster. In this case, it's three of a new armoured Fiend Palette Swap exclusive to Interlude, the Android Soldier. They each have 25,000 HP, and with only three party members, this could be a problem. However, I have Porum and Palum equipped with those twin stars I found, so that their twin cast will have them cast Meteor. The only issue once again is how painfully long it takes for them to charge the spell. After dealing enough damage, all three of them will merge into another boss, Deus Ex Machina. It hits the entire party with a strong beam attack, but then is hit by a blitz technique from Edge, who joins the party. This guy has 40,110 HP, absorbs fire and ice damage, but has a lightning weakness. The rest of this goes how you would expect. Cecil attacks, Porum heals, Palum casts Fundaga, and Edge casts Blitz. It doesn't take too long to bring down. Edge says he came here because he saw the Tower of Babel glow too, and figured someone was trying to get it running again. When reminded of Rydia, they enter the cannon room to find she's not there. So our next objective is to look for her. Last chest on B9 gets me a high potion. On floor B8, Medusa and Mithril Golem added to the bestiary. Floor B7, Security Eye, Purple Bavawa, Stone Golem and Steel Golem added to the bestiary. Stone Golem was the one I was trying to get as Edge alone, but gave up and decided to get it later. That's 94% of the bestiary, everything except for the entries for the final battle. Dry Aether is the final treasure in Interlude, and I move on to floor B6 where we fought Dr. Luge. We catch up with Rydia, and Edge compliments the disguise. He's the only one who can see that the Rydia we found in Seal Cave and journeyed with was never the real Rydia. The fake Rydia uses her newly acquired Eidolons to fight us with. She starts by summoning Shiva. These are all watered down versions of their Lunar Trial fights. Shiva has 12,800 HP, and a single Faraga takes over half of that. I also berserk Edge and he finishes her off. Rydia follows her up with Rama, who has 12,000 HP. Even with no weaknesses, he goes down in 4 hits. Ifrit is next with 14,000 HP. He goes down even quicker with Palum's Blizzaga hitting the damage cap. Finally, Titan with 15,000 HP. I think so little of Titan here that I don't even bother to cast Flow on the party. He goes down in no time. But then she follows up by summoning Bahamut. Edge says this Rydia is more powerful than the real one, which is not true in the slightest. Bahamut casts Mega Flare on the party, but then we get a repeat of the first game where the party is saved by Rydia's Mist Dragon at the last second. The real Rydia then shows up as Bahamut is defeated. Rydia's prey pissed at the person using her image to manipulate her friends, and the final battle starts against Rydia? She starts with casting Meteor, but it misses most of the party. I just have Cecil and Edge attack, Porum heal and buff when she can, Palum casts Fyrigger, and Rydia summon her own Bahamut. The fake will counter summons with Earthquake and throughout the tier 3 spells. She also has other enemy spells like Blaze. After a few turns, she's defeated. The fake Ridia fades away, leaving everyone wondering what was going on. Higher up in the tower, the fake, or another fake, says that they have completed the Eidolon system before it's appearing. Yeah, all of Interlude exists just to explain why the villain in the After Years looks like Ridia and can control Eidolons. We fear in Cecil and Rosa's room later on. Cecil worries for Rosa's health, but Rosa says she is healthy. In the throne room, everyone is waiting, worried about Rosa. Cecil enters and explains, Rosa isn't ill, she's pregnant. Everyone crowds around to congratulate, but no one brings up the timing of Rosa finding out she's pregnant the same day Yang's daughter is born. In fact, thanks to Yang telling nobody, Cecil learns that Yang's wife and his own are pregnant on the same day. And that's Interlude. It's nothing special really, completely disposable. The fake Ridia plot doesn't actually make the After Years' mysterious girl any more interesting, and all else we learn is that Cecil and Yang have kids, which is not a twist when released after the After Years in which those kids are major characters. Once I finish this video and can finally let FF4 out of my thoughts for the first time in years, I'll probably forget almost all of Interlude. Oh yeah, and this fucker had to weasel in a cameo because developers at Square are incapable of unwedging their tongues from his anus. Fully completing the bestiaries of both FF4 and Interlude has filled up the artwork collection to 52%. In case I really needed to look at Yoshitaka Amano's artwork pixelated to high hell instead of just looking it up on the internet. But that is Final Fantasy IV and the longest running project on this channel so far, fully complete. I really like this game. It's clearly one of the more simple RPGs from the early 16-bit era, but I also find it more fun than most of the others of its time. This is the earliest RPG I know of that trims a lot of the bullshit associated with the 8-bit days. It may be unfair to compare it to Phantasy Star 2 since they're 2 years apart, but that game really does show how much annoying fat FF4 trimmed. There's a big world for the time, but there's enough in it that it doesn't feel empty. We have some big dungeons, but you can actually tell rooms apart and there's no huge labyrinths with pointless time-wasting dead ends. You can make it through the game with a decent challenge without ever needing to stop and grind. It tells a simple plot, but there can be more characterization to appreciate if you look into it deep enough, without it being a story that's too ambitious and big for its time like I feel Phantasy Star 2 was. But thanks to the delay I had in covering this game thanks to my GBA save erasing itself, this game just missed its chance to be number one in the ranking. I had this plan to slowly build up the number ones. Because I know what I already like, I always had the idea that the top spot would go from Super Mario Bros. To Medieval to Spyro the Dragon to Soul Blade to Final Fantasy IV. But losing that GBA save meant that the first part of this game was in episode 16 instead of episode 7 as intended. And now by the time I finish this game, I've done the video on Mortal Kombat 2, which is a game I like more than this. So Final Fantasy IV is going to have to settle for second place in the current ranking. Although, if you want to feel sorry for a game's ranking, BCV has now been knocked out of the top 100. But of course, this isn't the last time we'll be seeing this world, hopefully. There is still the 3D remake to look at, and the sequel, The After Years. But not now. I have no idea when I'm getting to either of those. This game has been in my head constantly since I started recording games for this series in 2018, 4 years ago. I kind of need to stop thinking about it for a while.